Hello, welcome to Desiplaza TV United States. I am Epek Mule, the author of Mass Capitalism, a Blueprint for Economic Revival. I would like to thank Desiplaza TV for giving me an opportunity to interview a very important personality today, Professor Ravi Batra from Southern Methodist University, Dallas. It's a very, very critical time today for America, and we have a very important topic to discuss. The title of today's topic is Career Politicians and the Fury in America. While we have a lot of questions for Professor Batra, I would like to tell all my listeners and viewers that if you have any specific questions, you can tweet it with a hashtag Fury in America on Twitter, and we would like to get your questions answered. So before I start my interview, I would like to tell you something about Professor Batra. Dr. Batra is a professor of economics at Southern Methodist University in Dallas, and is the author of 6 international bestsellers. He was the chairperson of the department from 1977 to 1980. He has won many honors in his career. A magazine also selected him as a superstar economist in the world. The Prime Minister of Italy awarded him a Medal of Honor from the Italian Senate for his accurate forecast. Dr. Batra has authored many bestsellers, and 2 of his recent ones. This one is The New Golden Age, The Coming Revolution Against Political Corruption and Economic Chaos, and we're already seeing that happen today. And the most recent one, End Unemployment Now, How to Eliminate Joblessness, Debt, and Poverty, Despite Congress. That's very, very critical to say. Without the help of our uncooperative Congress, he has a way to help eliminate poverty from this country. So I have my questions for Professor Batra. Professor Batra, thank you for your time today, and it's a pleasure having you in Desiplaza studio. So let me start with my questions. The Obama administration talks about that they have created millions of jobs since 2009. Okay, it may be true. Then why is that people are so angry in this country? We are seeing this anger in the political presidential campaigns, and we are seeing people are really frustrated. And why is that today people support the likes of Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders, who have been really out of mainstream American politics? So can you, what do you think is happening?
Well, thanks, Apek, for inviting me to do this interview. Sure. I will be very happy to share my views. Sure. Yes, the claim from the administration is that millions of new jobs have been created. But then why are people so angry? The likes of Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders are not career politicians. They're not career politicians. And that's why they are popular. Right. They're popular because they have found something in the American voter. They have found that the American voter is very angry. Why? Because of rising poverty. Yes. According to the official claim, 14 million jobs have been created, but people are living on basically subsistence wages. Wages are so low. Why should they be so low when so many jobs are being created? That's a big puzzle that people want to solve. What happened in this so-called Great Recession of 2008? By the way, I had written in one of my books that this recession, by the way, that book, the New Golden Age,
yeah.
That book,
yeah.
Let me show you. This book was written in 2006. And I wrote in this book that a serious recession would start in 2007,
yeah.
And then just go on and on, on and on. The government would try to spend billions and even trillions of dollars to end poverty, end unemployment completely. But it would just, it would not end there. It would just go on and on because of so many bad things that have happened in the past 30 years. So I chose the date, the year 2007, and it happened in that very year, by the way. According to the National Bureau of Economic Research, this recession started in December 2007. And then according to them, it ended in 2009, but I wrote in the book, no, it won't end there. In fact, it would, in one form or another, it would go on and on, in spite of huge government intervention, until 2016. And then a revolution would take over. In 2016, a revolution would start, because a revolution starts when people become very angry. So I felt that this would happen by that year. There would be a lot of anger in America. Why? Because the rich would get richer with the help of government money. That's what I wrote. With the help of all the government money that they spend, the rich would get richer, but poverty in America would get worse and worse. And then it would be so bad that people would not believe their career politicians anymore, and they would want a change, and that's what is reflected in the popularity of Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders. So how bad is this poverty, first of all? How bad is this poverty? Well, according to the administration's own figures, American poverty is now the worst in more than 50 years. Right. It's the worst in more than 50 years.
Right.
And while they claim that the economy is really getting better, then there is a bank rate study. Bankrate.com has offered figures about how bad American poverty is. They say that more than 60% of Americans, more than 60% of Americans have no more than $500 in their savings.
Oh boy.
Just $500. That's not even half a month's rent in most cities. So the vast majority of Americans are just living on paycheck to paycheck. And then what's more, this former first lady, Laura Bush, she has done a study on hunger in America.
Okay.
And according to her, 49 million Americans go partially hungry every day.
My goodness.
Every day.
Interesting.
And 49 million Americans are not unemployed. Maybe 9 million are unemployed. What happened? The other 40 millions have jobs, but their wages are so low that they can't even feed their
family
properly.
Wow.
So this is how bad this poverty is. And the career politicians have no idea of why Americans are so angry. They keep wondering why. They want to stop Donald Trump from getting the nomination. And Bernie Sanders keeps saying that the economy is rigged against us, and the only the rich are getting richer. And this is what I've shown in this. Let me see this new book.
End unemployment now.
This one. I've shown in this book that the rich are getting richer with the help of the government money. The government itself is making the rich richer, and then I've heard also politicians say, why are the rich getting richer? This is too bad. This should not be happening in America. Well, it's very easy to show how government money makes the rich richer, but I'll talk about it as you go along.
Thank you for your very, very nice answer to this question. So it means that what's happening today, it's a good thing that people are rising up against political corruption. It's a good thing.
Well, that's what I wrote. You see, the revolutions occur when people get angry and they don't want to compromise.
Right, right, right. In fact, you said $500, that's a half rent in Dallas. I come from California. It's not even one third of our rent.
Yeah, that's right. So when people don't want to compromise, that's when revolutions occur. And I have seen anger in the eyes of the supporters of Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders.
Right.
They don't want to hear anything, no matter, even if it's logical from the old politician, they don't want to pay attention.
That's right.
Because they know these politicians for the past 30 years have done nothing for them.
Right.
And whatever they have done is designed to make the rich richer. Yeah. Everything they have done makes the rich richer, mm-hmm. and they simply fool the voters by sometimes they say, hey, abortion is bad, so yeah. vote for us. Yeah. Sometimes they say gay rights should be there, yeah. so vote for us. Yeah. But they don't tell people about their economic rights.
Right. Exactly.
People are getting poorer and poorer. They don't want to focus on that. Yeah. They want to focus on things which are trivial
right.
relative to right. hunger in America, relative to less than $500 savings in America. Right. So they want to focus on the triviality, and this is why people have been fooled so far.
So coming, catching up on the same thing, now what we are seeing today, the stock market, although is growing, it has reached 17,000. So it's at a very high level, almost more than 150% from its lows of 2009. So then how can this growth of the stock market happen when the wages are so low, or when the, when it's a low growth economy, that how is the stock market growing?
Very good question. How can the stock market break records when the economy is growing slowly and when the people are so poor?
Right.
Well, history shows that stock markets break records only when the economy is bad. That's the interesting part. Like, suppose, look at the 1960s in the United States. The 1960s are the golden years of American prosperity.
Okay.
And in that decade, a one wage earner, one person in the family, could support a family of four, have a house paid up, mm-hmm. have cars, could afford health care and education. Health care, by the way, was provided by businesses.
Mm-hmm.
And so this was the 1960s, and wages grew every year at the rate of 2%. At the rate of 2% per year, wages grew. So people were very prosperous. But the stock market was in a bad shape.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The stock markets always break records when the economy is in a bad shape and wages don't grow. This is what happened in the 1920s also. The stock market broke record after record, but wages were really very low. Although debt was high.
Mm-hmm.
Debt has to grow to support the stock market rise. So these things have been happening
right.
for the past 15, 20 years. So it's not a surprise that stock market is breaking records. But then eventually a stock market crash occurs. When the crash occurs, that's the day of reckoning.
Right.
Then people wake up. There is either a huge recession or a depression that happened in the 1930s, and now it happened between 2008 and 2010. The crash occurred.
Right.
But then the government, in my view, wasted trillions of dollars through huge government spending. So the federal debt has gone up by $10 trillion
yeah.
over the past 8 or 9 years,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
whereas the poverty rate is the highest ever in the last 50 years, over more than 50 years. So
right.
the question then comes, if it is not going to the people in terms of decent wages, where is it going?
Right.
Is it all going to the rich,
yeah.
top 1% of the people?
Right.
And they benefit not only from these low wages, but also from rising stock market.
Right.
So they are happy with all these deficits, although they openly denounce them.
Right.
They'll say, hey, the government has too much deficit, too much debt, but in the process, their own pockets are full. So this is all foolishness, you know.
Right.
This is foolish economy, and that's what I have shown in this latest book, and I have also shown how you can fix the economy very easily.
So, Dr. Batra, what do you think is the real cause of the falling wages and the soaring profits? What is the real cause? What is the root cause of this problem? Where does it come from?
You know, this is another good question you're asking uh-huh. because people want to know.
Yeah, yeah.
What's
happening?
Everybody wants to know.
Yeah.
Well, economics is a matter of purely supply and demand.
Okay.
It does not depend on emotional arguments, or it depends on low taxes, or depends on not many regulations and so on. In fact, if you look at history,
mm-hmm.
in the 1950s, mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
the top bracket tax rate, income tax rate was, the top bracket income tax rate was, listen to this, 91%. That is, if you earned a new high dollar, you were in the top bracket, and if you earned a dollar, out of that you paid 91 cents to the government. And still the economy was roaring.
Is it?
In the 1950s, American poverty fell at the fastest rate.
Right.
So all this is in my new book. I mean, I have government figures in this.
Right.
In the 1950s, the stock market did not rise much, but American poverty fell at the fastest rate, while the tax rate was 91% for the top earners. So these are purely emotional arguments. If you want to understand what's happening in the economy, look for supply and demand.
Right, right. Yeah.
Just supply and demand. Simple, two simple concepts. Now, when supply exceeds demand, when supply grows faster than demand, there is simply overproduction.
Yeah.
There's overproduction. Right. And that means there will be layoffs, because if a business is not able to sell all it is producing at the time, there will be layoffs.
Right.
And that will create overproduction and problems.
Let us take a break, small break at this point of time, and we'll have more questions coming from Professor Batra. Stay tuned. Welcome back, viewers. We are today having a discussion with Professor Batra on the subject, career politicians and fury in America. Just a reminder, if you have any questions, please tweet them with the hashtag fury in America, and would like to get them answered. Welcome back, Professor Batra. So we were discussing about the falling real wages and the soaring profits. So I'm trying to understand now, what causes this huge unemployment in the economy? And when you say that America's poverty is now more than highest in the 50 years, more than 50 years the highest. So what has caused this condition that we are facing today?
Well, that's exactly what I was trying to say. It's all a matter of supply and demand.
Okay.
If supply is greater than demand, then there is overproduction, and a business will produce only up to the level of whatever he or she can sell.
Right. Right.
So if supply exceeds demand, there's overproduction, and that causes layoffs. And when people are laid off, unemployment rises and wages have to fall. So the question then is, what causes this overproduction? What causes supply to exceed demand? Well, just remember that the main source of supply is labor productivity. When a person becomes more productive through new technology or better education, then production rises. So the main source of supply is productivity, and the main source of demand is a person's real wage, because you spend money out of your wage.
Right.
That's what creates demand. So when productivity rises faster than the real wage, supply rises faster than demand.
Right.
And then there is overproduction. So the only cause of unemployment is this productivity rising faster than the real wage.
Okay.
It has nothing to do with high corporate taxes or high taxes on the rich that people claim, or these high regulations. No, it's only a matter of supply and demand.
Right.
Okay. When productivity rises faster than the real wage, supply grows faster than demand, overproduction occurs, layoffs follow, unemployment goes up, the real wage also falls.
Very interesting.
So now the question is, why is this phenomenon occurring? There was no In the 1950s and the in fact, from the 1950s to up to the 1970s, wages grew as fast as productivity. Okay. But after the 1980s, they did not. So the question is why? The answer is all the government policies after that were designed to raise productivity and cut wages.
Okay. Okay.
So it's the government's policy that has created this excessive production, overproduction.
Right.
So what are the policies that occurred after the 1970s? First of all, it was the policy of people call it free trade. I don't call it free trade. It's called foolish trade.
Foolish trade. Okay.
It is foolish because you allow other countries' goods to enter yours freely.
Right.
But other countries don't allow your goods to enter there, and they call it free trade. No, right. It's foolish trade.
I agree. Yeah, very much.
So very much. After there were so many trade deals like NAFTA and WTO
TPP,
deals.
There's TPP coming
TPP
up.
TPP that came up just recently.
Yeah.
There were so many trade deals. All they do is they allow other countries to access American market, but other countries are free to distort their own markets and now not allow goods to come in easily.
Something I want to ask you based on this, because this is a confusion I'm seeing. I'm come from the technology industry, where we manufacture goods that raises the productivity. There is a difference between free trade and free market enterprise. I want you to explain our viewers what's the difference between free trade and a free market enterprise.
Well, free market means that there is a lot of competition among various industries.
Okay.
And we don't have free markets in that sense, because what we have is not free market capitalism, but monopoly capitalism.
Okay, right.
Mm-hmm. Where companies simply buy, large companies buy out small companies, small businesses, mm-hmm. and simply destroy jobs. See, whenever a large company takes over a small company,
layoffs
people are
laid off.
Yeah. And that causes, by the way, that was another point I was going to make, why wages have not been rising. What is part of government's own policies to let monopoly capitalism flourish.
Mm-hmm.
There is a anti-monopoly law, very strong anti-monopoly law in the United States, which says that a profitable firm should not buy up other firms.
When was this law passed?
This law was passed in 1995 or something. It's called the Sherman Antitrust Act.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So in accordance with this act, oil companies were broken up in 2011 to create competition in the oil industry. This was done in 2011. Now what happened in the 1990s, they allowed Exxon to buy up Mobil. They did the opposite of what had been done in 2011. Exxon and Mobil were born as two different companies when they broke up one big oil firm. Now these two firms merged and competition disappeared in the oil industry. And the result was $100 oil per barrel oil, even after the Great Recession started. So this is, again, a part of government policy which allows the rich to grow richer, which cuts competition. And so the result is, now when mergers occur, this type of mergers occur, productivity goes up. Because when they're laying off people and making people work harder,
right.
So productivity goes up.
Right.
But at the same time, real wages fall, so supply grows faster than demand.
Right.
There is overproduction, causes layoffs, and causes poverty. It's as simple as that. Nothing to do with all these high taxation or regulations. No, it's purely a matter of supply and demand.
Excellent, excellent. So, and I, when I read your book, End Unemployment Now, this is exactly what you explained in the layman's language, the real causes of the wage productivity gap is basically the supply-demand gap.
No, supply-demand
gap. Right.
Caused by the wage productivity gap.
So what I'm seeing in my semiconductor sector nowadays is that there are so many mergers and acquisitions that are taking place today that very few companies now have the money to invest in the future technological growth. And they don't want to invest because they are seeing that there is not significant demand. There is no return on there is no significant return on investment, is what they say.
So, in fact,
monopoly capitalism is what you say is also stalling the technological growth.
Oh, monopoly capitalism is bad everywhere. It's only good for the top 1% of Americans, top 1% of people anywhere in the world.
In fact, there was a study
done by Oxford University, I think it came out from Oxford. They said that about 50 people in the world own more than half the world's wealth.
Oxfam.
So this system of monopoly capitalism prevails everywhere in the world, and it benefits the top 0.1% of the world, among the richest people.
Mm-hmm.
Not even the top 1%, just top 0.1% of the people benefit from it, and the vast majority suffers from poverty.
Right.
And so my interest is in eliminating poverty all over the world, not just in the United States, but everywhere in the world, even in the economies of Africa, the rural economies of India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, everywhere there's a lot of poverty, and it hurts me to see that people become so rich while the vast majority don't even have enough to eat or afford a doctor and so on. But this is what I've done, that in this new book, I've found practical ways to eliminate poverty, not just in America, but all over the world. That has been my goal for the last, ever since I became economist, that was 50 years ago. This has been my cherished goal, to eliminate poverty everywhere.
Thank you very much, Dr. Batra. So one more thing I would like to check with you now. So you have this noble goal in front of you about eliminating poverty around the world. Let's start with the United States. What would you do to fix the U.S. economy? Because now we have presidential elections coming up, so what you say is going to help the upcoming president of this country.
That's right. Any president, whether the new or the current one, can eliminate poverty. Well, I shouldn't say eliminate, but cut poverty in half in just 1 month.
1 month. Wow.
In fact, 1 week.
1 week.
Yes.
1 week. Okay.
Any president of the United States, he or she, anyone, by taking certain actions, they can cut poverty in half very quickly. Now listen, see what's happening. The interest rate is very high nowadays. You may ask, where is the interest rate so high? People are paying 0%.
APR,
This is a 0% economy as far as the interest rate is concerned. But why do you say it's so high? Well, it's very high for the poor.
Okay.
That's the problem.
Okay.
It's very high for the middle class and the poor. Now imagine this. You have $500 in your savings account, and say your car breaks down. And you get a bill of $2,000. What do you have to do? You have to put it on your credit card.
Exactly. Yeah, you're right.
You don't have any savings.
Right.
You have to put it on your credit card.
Yeah.
And the bank charges you 20% interest rate on that.
Yeah.
The bank is paying 0% interest to the Federal Reserve.
Right.
And then the bank charges 20% from you. How can you ever get out of this debt?
Right.
How can you clear up this debt so you live from hand to mouth, can't afford to feed your family properly?
Did not think about that way. You're very right. Yeah.
Now, so why do they get away with this? They're paying 0% to the Federal Reserve and charge 20-25% interest rate on their credit card loans from the poor and the middle class.
Exactly.
From the rich people, they'll charge 5%. This is the craziness today. So how can the president help there? Well, there is no competition in the banking industry. There are only 5 banking giants, and everybody knows what the other bank is charging, so they don't have to reduce their interest rates at all. So one way to do this is to create competition among the banks. And we should do what they did to the oil industry in 2011, break up these large banks into smaller banks. And, you know, Bernie Sanders, by the way, is constantly talking about that idea that we should break up these large banks. But, of course, Congress would never get along, politicians, career politicians would never get along with this.
Yeah.
But the president can use a law which already exists on the books.
All right.
Congress has nothing to do with it now because the law is already there and the president can use that law. What is this law? This law says that the FDIC,
okay,
FDIC is an insurance corporation, insures your deposits with the banks.
Yeah.
The FDIC works under the president. It works. It's an agency that works for the president.
Mm-hmm.
And the FDIC can start its own bank. That's
okay.
What the law says.
Okay.
And the bank can exist for up to 3 years. So the FDIC starts its own bank and makes it solvent, puts some money into it. Then that bank can also borrow money at 0% interest rate from the Federal Reserve. And then that FDIC bank says, please, to all the credit card holders, transfer your loan balances to us.
Okay.
We will charge you only 5%. They can afford to charge 5% because they're paying 0% to the Federal Reserve. So they say, we'll charge you only 5%. And guess what happens in the entire banking industry?
Oh, everyone will go for 5%.
Everyone will go for 5%. And by the way, the FDIC can charter its bank within 3 days,
right,
in less than a week.
Mm-hmm.
So in less than a week, the FDIC can start its own bank. And just imagine all these people who are paying 20% interest on their huge loans,
mm-hmm,
on whatever they have borrowed, they have to pay only 5% now. Poverty is cut in half right away.
Interesting.
It won't take more than a month. It will take about a week.
Can I ask you one question regarding the same? Now, I recently saw the study that FDIC used to insure deposits up to $250,000.
Now they do that.
They changed it to $100,000?
It was in the past.
Yeah, yeah.
But after the Great Recession started,
yeah,
this limit went to $250,000. But, you know, the insurance part is nothing to do with this scheme.
Means they have the money to do that. Means
they have $40 billion in their own pocket,
okay,
in their own agency,
uh-huh,
and then by law they can borrow another $100 billion from the Treasury Department.
Interesting. Okay.
Yeah, so they have plenty of money.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
But then the money doesn't matter here because once you have started this bank,
yeah,
this bank can borrow unlimited amount of money,
mm-hmm,
from the Federal Reserve,
right,
at nearly 0%
rate. Yeah.
So they can handle all the business they get from the credit card owners,
uh-huh,
and so they can invite them, transfer their, and they can have a lot of bank branches. Banks have branches nowadays.
Right.
The FDIC bank can have lots of branches everywhere in the country.
Yeah.
So people transfer their loan balances to them. They charge only 5%. There is immediate jump in prosperity in America.
Right. You're right. You're right.
And see what will happen now.
Uh-huh.
First of all, poverty is cut in half. Now people have more money. Well, I estimated in this book that credit card loans are about $1 trillion.
Oh my goodness.
Total credit card loans in America right now, credit card debt is about $1 trillion. And suppose the interest rate falls by 10% because of this bank competition.
Right.
So there is $100 billion. $100 billion go mostly to the poor and the middle class,
right,
because they are the borrowers.
Right.
So this is like a $100 billion tax cut.
Yeah, tax cut. You're
with
right.
No increase in the budget deficit.
Oh yeah, that's very true.
So remember,
very true. Yeah.
Watch this again.
End unemployment.
End unemployment.
Now. Without Congress.
No, not just that. End joblessness,
debt
and poverty, despite Congress. So we want to cut the debt also.
Yeah.
So this will start cutting consumer debt, and this is $100 billion worth of tax cut without any increase in the budget deficit, so the government debt will also start to fall.
Thank you very much for this fantastic reply. We have more interesting questions for you, but I guess it's time to take a small break, and we'll come back to you on that.
Okay.
Stay tuned.
Thank you.
Welcome back. We are discussing with Professor Ravi Batra from Southern Methodist University, Dallas, on a topic, career politicians and future in America. Welcome back, Professor. So as we are discussing about ending unemployment without the help of our uncooperative Congress, and you also touched about doing that without raising the debt. So now let me ask you something. When we say that America's poverty is highest in 50 years, and the government has spent almost $10 trillion, I see, there is a rise in the federal debt of $10 trillion. So also the Federal Reserve has printed another $4 trillion to support the economy. So all this $14 trillion that has been gone into the economy, it seems like a huge waste of capital just to raise the poverty of the country.
That's right. Yeah. That's what has happened.
Yeah.
They have wasted $14 trillion of money while poverty has risen sharply. So it appears to an observer they've spent $14 trillion just to raise the country's poverty. The reason the poverty has risen is that much of this $14 trillion has gone into the pockets of the top 0.1% of the public, and that's why 50 people in the world, and this is the same thing has been happening in America.
All over the world, Europe,
China, Japan, everywhere. The government has been wasting money. Uh-huh. And so now just 50 people in the world own more than half the world's wealth.
Right.
So it is, it is terrible. And the sad part is that the economies can be fixed so easily without any increase in debt. All we have to do is to change policies.
Right.
Don't create monopoly capitalism, create free market capitalism. All, as you said, create mass capitalism.
Mass capitalism. So coming to regarding free market capitalism, I'm not taking any sides of any political party because I believe in good policies, good government policies. So we have a candidate from the Democratic side, Bernie Sanders. He talks about a lot of the things like about competition in the banks, about the corruption that is going on. And he talks about breaking up the big banks in one way. People accuse him of being a communist. But is it fair to call him a communist? What do you think about it?
Well, Bernie Sanders has lots of good ideas. We should not just break up banks. We should break up all major industries. Even the pharmaceuticals.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
There was a report recently that somebody increased drug price by 5,000% just to raise their profits. We should break up the pharmaceuticals, the banking, retailing giants. We need to create free market capitalism.
I guess even in the semiconductor industry, we need that.
That's right. Yeah. Free market capitalism and mass capitalism are the same thing.
Right.
And you have written a beautiful book, this mass capitalism book.
Thank you.
Wonderful.
So
let me finish talking about Bernie Sanders' ideas. They call him, he says that he is a democratic socialist. And he's right. He's not a communist at all. He wants people to have a voice in democracy, and that's democratic socialism. Right now what we have in America is corporate socialism.
Okay.
We have corporate socialism. So the socialism means the government intervening to help somebody in the economy.
Right.
That's socialism.
That's true.
So what the government is now doing, has now been doing for the past 30 years or 40 years, they have been intervening in the economy to help the rich.
Right.
So that's why it is corporate socialism. What Bernie Sanders wants to do is to have some government intervention to help the people,
right?
And that's what democratic socialism is. So his ideas are very, very, very good. And by the way, it's not just him.
Even Donald Trump.
Donald Trump is also offering some very good ideas, like
manipulating currencies. Other countries are manipulating the currencies. Free trade.
That's right. This is how they create this foolish trade,
right?
Which they call free trade.
Right.
The other countries manipulate currencies. They don't have tariffs now, but they have backdoor tariffs in the form of currency manipulation.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So it's the same thing that used to occur maybe 200-300 years ago, and that system was known as mercantilism.
All right.
Uh-huh. Not free trade, mercantilism. And so they remove tariffs or cut tariffs sharply, and then they say, well, this is free trade. No, it's not free trade at all,
right,
because tariffs are now there. Tariffs have now been replaced by currency manipulation. The end result is the same, that some countries have huge trade surpluses, others have huge trade deficits.
Right.
And it's so foolish nowadays. In the past, at least countries which had trade deficits, they were angry about it.
All right. Uh-huh, uh-huh.
They hated the idea of trade deficits.
Right, right.
Now, the economists are so perverse, the economic theory is so perverse, that they're very happy about the trade deficit.
They're going to negative interest rates, some countries with their central bank's policies. This is one of the
That's another part of their foolishness. But the United States doesn't even care, and they haven't cared for the past 30 years, how high their trade deficit goes up. They have a slogan, hey, this is free trade. So people are fooled by these slogans, but now they have found the reality that these so-called free trade deals like NAFTA and others are really at their own expense. It makes the rich richer, and both Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump are very much against this foolish trade, and I think that's the reason why career politicians have no more voice in selecting the presidential candidate.
Excellent, excellent. Thank you. So, Dr. Batra, in your book, End Unemployment Now, you told not just fixing U.S. economy, but also trying to eliminate poverty from the other nations around the world.
Oh, yes.
What do you think can be done by other nations, especially me coming from India? I would certainly like to see poverty go away from my country. So what can be done by other nations around the world to eliminate poverty?
That's right. The poverty in other nations is mostly in rural areas, in their villages.
Okay.
India has lately become a much stronger economy. But again, India almost has the growth of billionaires in India. Mm-hmm. I read an article recently. The growth of billionaires in India is the fastest in the world.
Yeah, fastest in the world. You're right.
And so all the money that they're also consumer debt has risen sharply, government debt has risen sharply. This debt makes the rich richer. You know, why does the debt rate make the rich richer? This is the idea people fail to understand. They think it helps the poor and the middle class.
Right.
See, when supply exceeds demand, supply is greater than demand, there are layoffs.
Right.
So then the government spends money.
Yes.
Or cuts interest rates to lure people into borrowing more money, so they create consumer debt and government debt.
Yes.
But this debt simply goes to the supplier. Supplier is the problem, cannot sell their product.
Yeah.
And the supplier's profits will sharply fall. But when the debt is created, this money goes to the supplier. Mm-hmm, so the supplier ends up benefiting. Others hardly see any benefit. So that's why the rich people get very rich when this consumer debt rises and the government debt goes up. And on top of that, when the banks charge 15-20% from the poor, then that they make huge money, huge profit. That's why you find that even when poverty is rising, the CEOs, their incomes are, 100 million a year. If it's less than 100 million a year, they say this CEO must have done something wrong. And even when the stock market crashed in 2008,
right,
the CEO,
the pay went up. Yeah,
their salaries went up.
Yeah,
because why? They got the government bailout.
Golden parachutes.
Not only that, that's their own profit. They got the government bailout from President Bush and then the subsequent President Obama, thinking that this is the right thing to do. All it does is raises debt in the economy, makes the rich richer, the poor get hardly any help, and that's why the poverty is the highest in the last 50 years. So now, coming to the question of how to eliminate poverty in other countries, what these nations are doing, they are inviting multinational corporations to come to their country and invest money.
You're right.
And these multinational corporations are happy to go there because they use low wage labor,
right,
and
tax cuts.
And tax cuts, a lot of help from the government.
Right.
They're very happy to go in. Then they import those goods into the United States,
right,
create low wages here, and their own profits jump.
Right.
So the best way to, and then there are other problems. See, jobs are created in urban sectors, in the cities, and people move from villages to the cities in search of jobs.
Urban congestion.
And urban congestion, there is more pollution, urban problems, and people are uprooted, you know, from their, where they live.
So
we can get rid of all these troubles simply by creating industries in the rural areas, in villages.
Absolutely.
Why?
Labor is cheap over there. Why not go there?
Why not go? Exactly. And why call, ask people to come to the cities and find jobs? Why not move industry to villages?
Right.
Now, how do we do that? And this can be done with very small investment, by the way.
Okay.
It doesn't take much investment. You know, here they are inviting, spending a huge amount of money to build factories in the cities, but you don't have to build these factories. You can take, you can follow what was named in Europe. There was a system used in Europe at the start of industrialization.
Okay.
This system was called putting out system. This is pre-capitalist industrialization. And this did not require large investment because people were given machines by merchants. Merchants distributed machinery to workers who worked in their own homes. So they did not have to build huge buildings, and that requires a lot of investment. So now they can do the same thing.
Sitting from home.
But here the government has to be involved because these merchants are predatory. They are charging huge, they have a huge markup on whatever things are built up. Like in India, we have a huge cottage industry.
Right.
But these workers in the villages who produce these goods are still very poor.
Right, I agree with you.
What happens is these merchants will have a $500 markup on the goods they buy.
The price,
So they become very rich, but the people don't get any benefit. So here the government has to be involved. So what the government should do is this. Buy machinery, distribute it to people in the villages. They work in their own homes, and they should buy the best type of newest technology so that workers' productivity goes up. And then the government should buy these products from those people and then market them. Marketing is a very tough job.
Right.
You can build goods and services. People can build goods and services from their homes, but how do you sell them to the public? Instead of selling these goods through the merchants, through these middlemen, the government, they can sell these goods through with the help of the government. So the government can buy these goods from those people working at home and then market it for them, and they should have a low markup.
Okay.
They don't have to make themselves very rich. The government doesn't have to enrich itself. So when they have a low market, these goods will sell at a very low price.
Okay, all right.
And there will be a lot of demand for the goods built in villages. And villages will also get a good size of the profit. And here you have a poverty elimination scheme without much investment. You don't need much investment because you don't have to build factories.
Okay, right.
In the rural villages.
Right.
And then since the government is marketing it and charging low prices from the public, there will be a lot of demand for such goods built there, and the profit would mostly go to the workers.
Right.
And their poverty will be eliminated very fast. And all it will take is 1 or 2 years because building factories takes a long time.
Right.
Distributing machinery by the government will not take much time. Now, if people need some training, they may not be able to work on these machines. Well, the government can open centers of training also for them.
Right.
And so this way, industrialization can start in villages itself, and people will get rid of their poverty easily.
Dr. Batra, now I need to check out, since you have already read my volume, first volume, Mass Capitalism, a Blueprint for Economic Revival,
And you also wrote a good review for it. I was very glad to read your review. But now, I'm a believer in true free markets where the role of government is minimal. You know, I believe that when we have a smaller government, you can also eliminate income taxes, try to eliminate income taxes on the people because you don't need the minimal, the smaller the size of government, lower the taxes that people have to pay. So what I do believe in what exactly you want to do, but I try to get that approach with the kind of a university and industry conglomerates is what I believe that you can train the workforce, you can do that. And I also believe that we have the upcoming industrial revolution, the Internet of Things, and you are putting out system might be a good thing before the start of the next industrial revolution 4.0, where I personally believe if you can empower the villagers through the e-commerce business, that's a much better approach that they can get market all across the world. So people like me who are, you know, who could help them with getting launching their products on our e-commerce platforms and they can get it done. So coming to my volume again, mass capitalism blueprint, I would like to ask you, you called my book The Wave of the Future in your review. And can you please tell our listeners why you consider this to be a wave of the future? Can you please tell us something about it?
Well, if you want to have an economy which rarely has unemployment and fall in wages, then you need mass capitalism. Mass capitalism is the same thing as economic democracy.
Okay.
We don't have economic democracy. Right now we have corporate socialism.
Right.
You need economic democracy so that there never is another wave of high unemployment and suffering in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Now remember, unemployment occurs when productivity rises faster than the real wage.
Right.
So the wage productivity gap rises, that creates a demand supply gap, and then there are layoffs. So if you have economic democracy, an economic democracy is a system where the majority shares of large companies, not small businesses,
right,
of large companies
publicly traded companies.
No, not just. There are some very small companies that are publicly traded also, but okay, large companies like, you know, Microsoft, Apple, IBM, etc., when the majority shares of such companies are owned by workers themselves.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. That's economic democracy.
Employee-owned businesses, that is what?
But those are small businesses.
Businesses, you know. Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
Now, here we're talking about large corporations which have millions of shareholders.
Right.
But the majority of these shareholders are
the employees.
Should be in the hands of the employees themselves, and that is mass capitalism. Now, what happens if that's the case? These employees, these workers, would have their own board of directors.
Right.
They would control the board of directors, and the board of directors will be thrown out if productivity rises and wages don't. They will be thrown out.
Right.
Then this board of directors will work in the interests of
employees.
Not just employees, masses.
Yeah, exactly.
Masses.
One way to say masses.
So whenever productivity goes up, real wages will also rise.
Right.
And there will then be no overproduction.
Yeah.
And
economic
no
balance.
Layoffs ever.
Right.
The supply-demand balance will be automatically maintained
right.
in economic democracy.
Yeah.
So if you want an economy which rarely has problems of unemployment and poverty,
yeah.
then in the end you need mass capitalism or economic democracy.
I think so. We have a few more questions to cover up, but I guess it is a time to take a short break, and we'll be right back. Please stay tuned. Thank you. Welcome back, viewers. We are talking with Professor Ravi Batra on the topic Career Politicians and Fury in America. We have received some of the questions on Twitter, and I would like to address one of the questions. Now, I personally believe, coming from an engineering background, I don't know how much fair it would be, but I would still ask Professor Batra, from an economic perspective, what do you think, how can technology be used in erasing poverty, or what is the role of technology in erasing poverty around the world?
Technology has a very, very, very important role to play.
Uh-huh.
I mentioned this, how to eliminate, how to use the putting out system in villages in around the world.
Okay.
See, what we now have is monopoly capitalism.
Uh-huh.
Before this, we had free market capitalism.
Okay.
And prior to that, we had this putting out system.
Okay.
In which machines were distributed to workers in small towns and villages, and they worked from their home, and then the merchant would collect the product and market it.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And the merchant got very rich using this system. So what I'm saying now is, the government this system can be adapted for the rest of the world. The government should distribute machines to workers in the villages or small towns, and these machines should have the latest technology.
Okay.
Because one reason why the cotton industry workers in India and Pakistan or Bangladesh, one reason why they are still poor is that their productivity is very low.
Okay.
Because they're using outdated machines,
right.
So here we are saying, no, the government should give them the best machines possible,
mm-hmm.
Their productivity would go up and they would produce a lot. Now the question is, how do you sell all this production? Well, the government buys it from them at reasonably low prices, gives them high prices, and do not increase and have a reasonable markup on these. So the consumer will also face low prices. Demand for these goods will rise. All the production that has occurred in these villages will be sold out, and the new technology will raise their productivity and give them a very decent living standard. So that's the role of...
One thing I could tell you is that with the rapid progress in technology that we are seeing nowadays, where the productivity is steadily increasing with the use of, you know, when the computers replaced human beings in office, a job of 8 hours could be done in 1 hour.
Exactly.
So now, I personally believe, still, if you want to maintain keep the wage productivity gap from not increasing too much, that is the root cause of problem you suggest. I also believe that there has to be a policy where there should be, for the technological growth to continue and for the productivity to ever grow, there has to be a way for cutting down the work hours of the employees without affecting the
output.
Poverty.
Without affecting output.
Output, yeah. Because if we are producing too much because of technology and there is not significant demand, then we cannot sell those goods. But in case of a recession or when there is slowdown in the economy, if workers reduce the work hours, they can still manufacture the desired output with less work hours.
Well, that's interesting, and that will automatically happen if we have economic democracy.
Mass capitalism.
If we have mass capitalism, that would automatically happen.
Uh-huh.
Because nowadays what happens, if demand goes down or does not rise, then these layoffs occur.
Right.
And then the government has to support the laid off people through this unemployment compensation.
Right.
And by increasing taxes.
Right.
But if suppose working hours were to fall,
mm-hmm.
and why should anybody be laid off because people jointly own the firm? So if working hours were to fall, then there will be nobody unemployed. The government would not have to pay any unemployment compensation. The government would not have to collect taxes for that.
Right.
There would be no need for debt.
So it's a good thing for people that they will have to pay less income taxes, isn't it?
That's
so
right.
People should support mass capitalism because you will have to pay lower income taxes. What more do you need now?
Exactly. So the government size would also be small.
Yeah.
You won't need bureaucracy,
yeah.
that huge bureaucracy to manage unemployment compensation.
Right.
So the government size will be small. You'll have free markets and there will hardly be a reason for unemployment because wages rise as fast as productivity.
Right, right.
And so this is a win-win
for everyone.
Situation,
yeah.
Solution for
everybody. Except for career politicians.
Except for career politicians and the richest people in the world.
Perfect. We had a very fantastic discussion with Professor Batra on the subject career politicians and fury in America. You can certainly, I would recommend people to get educated and do read the volumes authored by Professor Batra. He has other volumes also listed on the website, but I do recommend The New Golden Age and End Unemployment Now. For more details about his forecasts, to visit his website, that's ravibatra.com, RaviBatra.com. You can also consider reading my volume, Mass Capitalism, which is also recommended by Professor Batra. There are some good reviews on Amazon. And you can also visit my website to read about me and about my blogs. It's epekmulay.com, APEKMULAY.com. I guess we had a fantastic discussion so far, and I hope this upcoming this interview would help Americans understand what is the root cause of problem, what is the root cause of the anger, and how the upcoming elections is so critical from the point of view of restoring prosperity for themselves and for the country. So it's time to make America great again through restored by establishing free market capitalism. Remember, we don't have free market capitalism. As per Professor Batra, he says we have a monopoly capitalism that we need to get rid of. And career politicians do not want monopoly capitalism to go away because it is their job security. So let us bring about this intellectual revolution to get rid of the job security of the career politicians. Let us put them on probation through these ideas of Professor Batra and mass capitalism that I have put forth. Thank you, Desiplaza, for your time, for letting me introduce Professor Batra today and helping educate the Americans about the state of our economy and the upcoming elections, and also how we can address the real problems rather than blaming it on racism, on all other issues that people are really worried about, that, okay, this is what's happening in the election campaign. So root cause is the growing poverty and not the other things that are being propagated by the media. So please be aware of that and make sure that your vote does not go waste. We don't recommend any politician, but we do believe that Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump do want to do something good for this country. So thank you very much again, Desiplaza, and you have a wonderful time ahead. Thank you.